American Heritage has a different culture than anything you will have experienced in another school.
We ask the children at American Heritage School if they will be like Jesus. We tell them that the principals, the teachers, the custodians, the librarians, the lunch ladies, everyone here wants to be like our Savior Jesus Christ. That's our goal.
Because of the generous heart of so many people who've gone before, people who have built this building, teachers who sacrifice at a lower wage, there are many who have contributed to the scholarship for each child who comes to American Heritage School. There's so much that's given, and we expect everyone to be willing to give and to sacrifice. That's the spirit of American Heritage School.
It really goes back to what we learned in Gethsemane. We're all debtors to someone else. And those who gave to this school so that we could all be here at half the real cost to be here, those who gave understood that they were debtors as well. That's what permeates the classrooms and the hearts and the minds at American Heritage School.
When we educate hearts and minds, we get a whole child. When the focus is only on the mind, President McKay said that that will produce a lively villain and a clever devil in our children. We want to educate their hearts so that they are completely educated. And we find each year, as we administer our nationally norm reference tests, that our children do far better than the world around them, the state around them, because their hearts are educated. When you educate a child's heart and cause them to love learning and to seek truth, when you educate their heart in character, the academic learning automatically follows because they better understand who they are and what their mission is.
The overriding purpose of our honor code is that each of us is striving to live in a place, in a way that we are worthy to have the Holy Ghost here in our school and to have the Holy Ghost in our hearts.
The school isn't for everyone. I wish it was.
We strive to follow the different standards that are set, for example, not dating until we're 16, honoring and obeying our parents, being worthy to go to the temple, reaching out in kindness to others and being a good friend. As we strive to follow those both at home and at school, we are better able to follow Jesus Christ.
Talking a little bit about the honor code, I had a 16-year-old daughter who was considering coming here, and she had been attending a public high school. And one of her drawbacks was, am I gonna be able to handle all the rules and the uniform and everything? And all I could assure her at the time was, it'll be worth it, you'll see.
I would encourage parents to be fully aware of the uniform policy and that it will be enforced at the school.
For someone who's hesitant about being able to meet these expectations, this is such a loving environment. And when somebody has a difficult time remembering all the many things to remember, we lovingly put our arms around them and say, we are so glad you're here. Here is an expectation I want to remind you of. Let me help you. It's a very nurturing, loving atmosphere.
In life, we make commitments all the time. And it's one commitment that students make to follow the honor code of our school. Being able to be trusted is one of the greatest gifts that we can give to our family members, to our friends, and ultimately to employers and to the world. As students learn to keep their commitments here at this school, they become so much better prepared for life.
We help our children to understand the statement by President Benson, when obedience ceases to be our irritant and becomes our quest, in that moment God will endow us with power. But if we refuse that endowment, then we may need to look elsewhere for a better fit in terms of our education.
Everything they do in the school is to enhance the spirit, is to bring unity and feelings of unity among people.
There's a passage in the Honor Code, always honor and serve, AHS. And I love the word always. Always, as defined by Mosiah chapter 18, if you recall the people at the waters of Mormon, there was a covenant made there to stand at all times and in all places as witnesses of Christ. That's what always means. Not just when people are watching, not just at school when the teacher is looking, or not just here when everyone is together, but at home in the quiet places.
Always honor and serve. That's what American Heritage School stands for. If they will honor and serve, they will be directed to the Honor Code. If they live the Honor Code, they will be guided to honor and serve.
I've seen in the last 2 years something that I've not seen before, which is students who feel so strongly about this, not only for themselves, but for others. This is that love thy neighbor concept, that they have worked and saved to help pay a classmate's tuition in order for that classmate to be here, always anonymous. The classmate hardly knows that it's a student who is helping to support them here. They probably think that it's a wealthy donor somewhere. But these kinds of great personal sacrifice, the widow's mite, if you will, is present in 100 and 1,000 ways here that I wish we could communicate in detail so that those who come realize how deeply and broadly this culture of sacrifice exists, even down to students working for other students to be here.
Many people have sacrificed so that you can be a student here, and you're honoring their sacrifice by doing your homework, by being prepared for class, and by being your best to be a good student while you're in class. And so we have those expectations of you.
Our faith as an institution is not an excuse for academic mediocrity. Just the opposite. Our faith should encourage academic excellence, and it does. But to any who are concerned that they may not be academically excellent enough for our standards or our expectations of the school, I would say to those, come with a humble heart, willing to work hard, because work ethic makes all the difference when it comes to academics. Come with a humble heart, ready to work hard, and you will succeed.
I would say, number one, pray. To have an open heart and an open mind. Number two, work as if it all depended on you, then pray to know that it all depends on the Lord.
Our doors are open to all who are willing to work hard and come with a humble heart to put character as higher than intellect and be a part of that culture.
Academic probation is not, it's not really getting you in trouble. It's warning you that you need to be observant of your grades And so when we have students that have grades that are non-passing, so a D or an F at our school does not receive credit, and this is just in grades 7 through 12, the process works that I will meet with a student and talk to them about their grades. Sometimes there's things that we can do, like set up a schedule for a time that they can do homework. Sometimes they don't have materials that they need. We'll communicate with their parents if the issue becomes one that goes on for longer than 2 or 3 weeks. And then students can be placed on academic probation, and if their grades go on at a non-passing level for a substantial period of time, it can be considered in their readmission process for the next year.
This building is given to us by the generosity of others who sacrificed, who could have used their money in many other directions for their own comfort or convenience. Instead, they chose to make that sacrifice for our benefit. This building is a gift, and the manner in which we care for it needs to honor that gift. We need to show our gratitude. We must show that gratitude and be willing to make our own personal sacrifice to keep the building clean, to care for the building in appropriate ways, not just physically, but to do in this building what is appropriately done here, what the spirit and the sacrifice require of us.
We show a great deal of respect to this building because it has been donated to us by people who are very generous. And we ask students to always be cognizant of that in the way that they are acting in the building, to not run in the hallways, to only eat food in designated areas, to not chew gum on campus. In all that we do, we want to show respect to people who made great sacrifices so that we could have this beautiful building in this beautiful location across the street from the temple. And so we always do our best to treat the building with love and care so that it can be maintained for ourselves, for our children, for our grandchildren to come and enjoy this beautiful atmosphere here.
What it comes down to, I believe, are the attributes that are emblazoned over the entrances to the school, beginning with humility. That's the very first one. Humility is the gatekeeping attribute to a great person and learner. Following in its wake come so many good things: virtue, charity, industry, wisdom, self-government.
An ideal student wishing to come to American Heritage would be one who is willing to give his consent to be taught all of truth and its author, Jesus Christ, who would seek that knowledge and then be willing to govern his life by it.
The spirit in their lives is the most important thing that they can attain to in life. So beginning with humility and having a worldview that invites Christ and His Spirit into everything that a student does would define a model American Heritage School student.
Talk about having the best team in the world come on board with you in fulfilling that mission and role as a parent.
We work together. I just don't walk away and leave my kids here. I'm expected to be involved in their homework. I'm expected to come to parent-teacher conferences and discuss issues that my children may have. I'm also expected to give 30 hours of service time, which is really easy because I love being here in the classes and helping with the teachers. I love just sitting in and listening.
Broadly, that we just love having the parents here, helping in the classrooms, being aware of what's going on, and asking good questions at home to help reinforce what's happening in the classroom so that it carries on at home too.
The ideal parent would be one who wants that instruction for his child, wants his child to be filled with truth by a loving teacher who loves the Lord, therefore will love their child and will teach and train him in all the ways of the Lord, who will use every curricular subject, whatever it may be, algebra, grammar, art, music. All curricular subjects are tools by which we bring children into Christ. That is true education.